Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming to the lecture tonight. Our guest tonight will be, and is actually, Catherine Malabou, currently professor at Kingston University in the UK. Catherine Malabou is, I'm sure, already well known to most of you. Her work includes up to now, I think, if I counted well, about 13 books, or precisely 13 books. Two of them are co-authored, one with Judith Butler, the other with Adrian Johnston. Among, if I would have to single out her most important and inspiring book, and I'm being here quite subjective, that would be the book The New Wounded, in which Catherine puts together, or actually builds out something that is very very the specificity of her writing, and she's working at the intersection of philosophy, psychoanalysis, and neurosciences, and in her book The New Wounded, all those disciplines are taken into consideration and applied to the concept of trauma. Also, I would like to mention her book on destructive plasticity, as well as her excellent book Changing Difference, which deals with the question of the feminine. And probably the first word, the first notion that would come to mind when thinking about Catherine's work would be the concept of plasticity, and indeed it can be considered as central to her work, both plasticity as she takes it over from Hegel's philosophy, and neuroplasticity in medical sciences. But without further ado, the topic of Catherine's lecture tonight is the question of gender, the question of the feminine, and Catherine will use, actually uses the famous text written by Jean-Paul Sartre, the Anti-Semite and the Jew, in order to, actually she finds parallelisms in the way the Jew is constructed and the way the feminine is constructed. So let's give a cordial applause to our dear guest.
Thank you very much. Is this working? Thank you very much for inviting me, and I'm sorry, I will read the paper because I'm not really able to improvise on such topics, so I hope this won't be too boring. So again, thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you, Željka, for your introduction. And yes, I intend to talk about, let's say, not only post-feminism, but also post-gender theory. And this talk will be both a reading of Jacques Derrida's text on Nietzsche, which is called Spurs, Nietzsche's Style, and as Željka was just saying, Jean-Paul Sartre, the Anti-Semite and the Jew. Okay, it is woman who will be my subject. Woman will not have been my subject. I intend to situate my discourse between these two well-known statements by Jacques Derrida in his book Spurs, Nietzsche's Style. So it is woman who will be my subject. Woman will not have been my subject. The French subject designates both subject in the sense of subjectivity and topic. So Derrida's statements then mean that woman will and won't constitute the topic of his lecture, which lets us immediately understand at the same time that if woman is not, cannot be a topic, properly speaking, it is because precisely the woman is not and cannot be a subject. Or, to say it differently, women can only be dealt with as a topic, as a non-subject, that is, as someone who is always already deconstructed. Sorry. The feminine, then, designates in Derrida's lecture the impossibility of the woman as a topic and as a subject, that is also as an essence. Deconstruction appears in that respect to be one of the most consistent and operative anti-essentialist discourse. A discourse which, of course, immediately resonates with the leading post-feminist and gender theory orientations from the end of the 20th century. There is no such thing as an essence of woman. Very often, this sentence has been opposed to, for example, Simone de Beauvoir's work, considered to be essentialist. Against this kind of discourse, it has been affirmed again that there was no such a thing as an essence of woman. And this is precisely such a deprivation of essence that I would like to interrogate and challenge here. In order to do so, I propose to introduce a third sentence to the Derridean duet. Woman will be my subject, woman will not have been my subject, and what I would like to introduce is woman negates this negation itself. This will help me to situate the woman not as a non-subject, but as a negative subject, as someone who negates the negation of her essence. The difference between a non-subject and a negative subject is that the first is passive. It is just a non-subject. A non-subject refers to something like impotentiality, even impotency. The second, like negative subject, on the contrary, becomes a locus of power. It pertains to the dialectical power to transform a deprivation of essence into a form of essence. Why the need to introduce this third term, this third sentence? What is the need of reintroducing dialectics after deconstruction? Stating that the woman is not a subject, has no essence, that the feminine is the paradoxical expression of the impossibility of the woman, has long been considered an emancipatory feminist statement or move. I think, on the contrary, that anti-essentialism is nothing but a violent gesture. My contention is that depriving woman of essence is violent. In the book Željka was talking about, Changing Difference, I even argued that there might be a secret community between this theoretical violence and domestic violence in the practical sphere. In both cases, the woman is negated. In both cases, the woman is under control. The problem then is how to counter such a violence, how to reintroduce something like the essence of woman without returning to essentialism. I propose the idea of a minimal concept of woman, according to which woman refers to a subject overexposed to a specific type of violence. This minimal concept is to be understood in relation to the negative subject previously exposed. It designates an identity formed by negation. The woman would be formed by what negates her. It is, in a sense, violence alone which would confer her her being. I have been criticized for not having made this sufficiently clear. I thought I then had to elaborate more on this idea of a minimal essence, and hence, woman as a negative essence will be my subject. Woman as a dialectical essence will be my subject. The dialectical plasticity of essence will be my subject. The idea of a negative definition of identity, more exactly, the idea of an identity formed by negation, is certainly not new. One of its most striking expressions is undoubtedly, as it has been remembered, that of Sartre in his book Réflexions sur la question juive, Anti-Semite and Jew. I quote from Sartre, "The Jew is one whom other men consider a Jew." That is the simple truth from which we must start. It is the anti-Semite who makes the Jew, and makes is underscored. And again, anti-Semitic violence makes the Jew. End of quote. Such a making is precisely for Sartre the making or the fashioning of an essence, the essence of someone, I quote again, who asserts his claim in the face of the disdain shown toward him. End of quote. And of course, this negating essence is also positive to the extent that the Jew, according to Sartre, I quote again, makes himself by himself a Jew. Il se fait juif de lui-même et par lui-même against the very violence which is done to them. So the essence of the Jew does not pre-exist its negation, it is the result of its negation. Out of negation, the Jew makes themselves. So in order to explore the kind of ontology required by this negative essence, that is an essence shaped by destruction, a plastic essence, and before returning to Sartre in conclusion, I first have to explain my first statement, according to which anti-essentialism is violent, unacceptable, and requires that we elaborate a post anti-essentialist type of feminism, a post-gender theory kind of discourse. I will then leave Sartre for a moment and follow Derrida's trajectory in spurs and bring to light the violence it contains. Very clearly, spurs presents itself as an anti-essentialist discourse on women. The expression, "woman will be my subject," appears right in the beginning of Derrida's lecture as a substitution. Initially, Derrida says, he wanted to talk about style, and the title of the book is Nietzsche's Style. But then he decided that woman instead would be his subject. I quote Derrida. The title for this lecture was to have been The Question of Style. However, it is woman who will be my subject. And he goes on, still, one might wonder whether that does not really amount to the same thing. Okay? So initially, Derrida says, the question of woman and the question of style appear to be one and the same question. This identity is not simple, though, and this is what Derrida will show, because it paradoxically proceeds from a dividing line, a dividing line within identity, which he follows through Nietzsche's text. He shows that Nietzsche, who is the first philosopher to have addressed the question of style, is a contradictory philosopher, because he has two kinds of discourses on style, and consequently also on women, as if there were two women in Nietzsche. And Derrida will show that when woman in Nietzsche is essentialist, and one and the other is anti-essentialist. And this double discourse precisely coincides with the double discourse on style, as well as with the double discourse on the Jew, and we'll see that it is quite, of course, quite different from what Sartre says. So I will explore this dividing line in Nietzsche and consequently also in Derrida and then come back to Sartre in conclusion. Derrida's reading of Nietzsche in spurs entirely revolves around Nietzsche's two affirmations. First, the one in Beyond Good and Evil, where Nietzsche says, truth is a woman. And a second affirmation in The Twilight of the Idols, where Nietzsche says, the idea becomes female. In German, the Idee wird Weib. Again, there are two Nietzsches in Nietzsche, two women in Nietzsche. And that's why there are two contradictory understandings of these affirmations by Nietzsche himself. The first understanding, as I said, is essentialist. And we know how many expressions of anti-feminism and misogyny there are in Nietzsche. And they all pertain to essentialism. From that perspective, to say that the truth is feminine amounts to saying, for Nietzsche, that the essence of woman is just falsity, seduction, illusion, false truth, lie, or appearance. Therefore, it is necessary, Nietzsche says, to remain far away from women. Derrida says, it is necessary to keep one's distance from the feminine operation. Woman, Derrida goes on, is skepticism and veiling dissimulation. The idea of a becoming female of the idea is a paroxystic expression of this contention of woman. In Twilight of the Idols, Nietzsche goes even further. The woman is not only a liar, a seducer, she's also Christian. And Nietzsche adds, the idea becomes woman, and then it becomes Christian. What does that mean? Not only the woman is an error, a seducer, but it also appears as the Christian essence of the Western concept of truth. Why that? Derrida explains, because female and Christianity refer to the same thing, which is castration. The woman is castrating. The idea is castrating. And the link with Christianity is that, for Nietzsche, Christianity is an entire operation of castration. I quote Derrida, the extraction of a tooth, the plucking out of an eye, as precisely described by Nietzsche to be precisely Christian operations. In this sense, the violations that are perpetrated by the Christian idea, that are the idea, become woman. So the woman, like Christianity, would be the one who extracts, who cuts the vitality in our body. And here we find the traditional hyper-essentialist association between woman and castration. The traditional contention that we also find in Freud, according to which woman is castrating by essence. So we see that from this perspective, essentialist perspective, the essence of woman is said twice to be a falsity, that of error, and that of castration. But then at this point, at the same time, I said it was a dividing line, Derrida shows that there's quite another discourse on women in Nietzsche. There is like a second understanding of the same affirmations as was quoting in the beginning, woman, well, the truth is woman, and the idea becomes female. And Derrida shows that Nietzsche draws a quite a different conclusion between the association, from the association between woman and appearance or dissimulation. There is, according to Derrida, a non-essentialist contention of, well, a non-essentialist vision of on the woman of the woman in Nietzsche. From this second perspective, lying, dissimulation, seduction are said to be female operations, but in a positive sense, because they can be understood as artistic gestures, mimics, imitations without models, precisely without essences. In Nietzsche, the woman and the artist philosopher now appear as inseparable. Nietzsche also says, Derrida quotes, das Weib ist so artistisch, woman is so artistic. Art would reveal, just as women, the existence of an originary simulation, not falsity, but an originary imitation, simulation, which suspends, Derrida says, I quote, the decidable opposition between the true and the non-true. This second way of reading appears through Nietzsche's issue of style, through Nietzsche's own style, through the fact that there can be no philosophy, that is, no truth, without a style. And then the discourse on the woman appears totally different. The woman appears here suddenly as the style of truth, not as I said, as an error or a lie, but as a writing, as a way of writing, as an artistic mode of being, as what has always been repressed by philosophy's radical phallogocentrism, as Derrida calls it. The style has no essence. I quote Derrida, style uses its spur as a means of protection against the terrifying, blinding, mortal threat of that which presents itself. So style is used against essence, end of quote. And therefore, the question of style and that of woman are one and the same question. Woman becomes the simulacrum of truth, the simulacrum of castration, but without original, a simulation which inscribes its passage in the depth of metaphysics and remains legible as a trace, the trace of simulation within truth, the comedy of Christianity within Christianity, a transvestite, the affirmation of an artistic gesture. So from the perspective of the second reading, which opens the issue of the woman artist, of the woman as style, I quote Derrida again, there is no such thing as the essence of the woman, because woman averts, she is averted of herself. Out of the depths, endless and unfathomable, she engulfs and distorts all vestige of essentiality, of identity, of property. Further, woman, truth, will not be pinned down. In truth, woman, truth, will not be pinned down. So another Nietzsche then appears, a genuinely feminist Nietzsche. Another woman also appears, a woman without essence, a woman with no essential subjectivity. The loop is now closed. It is woman who will be my subject, and it has been, like at essence, Nietzsche 1, and woman will not have been my subject, Nietzsche 2, no essence of woman. So we might stop here and say that in Derrida this conclusion looks like a dialectical one, because there's something like an inversion in Nietzsche's text. There's something like the negation of the negation of the essence of woman. But the problem, according to me, and this is what I propose for the discussion, is that this negation of the first negation does not redouble itself to produce the concept of what a negative essence might be. It just remains what it is. Woman has an essence, there is something like an essence of woman, there is no essence of woman. Essentialism is negated. This negation produces an anti-essentialism, but we need a third moment. Hegel would say something is missing. This double negation is not speculatively redoubling itself in order to produce something out of this absence of essence. And precisely, according to me, this juxtaposition, like essence, non-essence, is what precisely appears as violent, as a kind of violence which is done to women. Where does this violence originate itself? Precisely, according to me, it originates in the artistic paradigm. We have noticed that Nietzsche, according to Derrida, inverts his discourse when he considers woman as the artist. The link which is drawn in Nietzsche's discourse between the artist and the woman, a link which in his turn Derrida takes for granted, in reality appears to be the expression, according to me, of a highly repressive and normative ontological frame, that of simulation and dissimulation. The fact that Derrida says, yes, but this time dissimulation, imitation is without models, is that they are copies without originals, does not change the fact that they remain imitations. Here is violence, according to me, to encapsulate artists and women in dissimulation, even if, once again, this dissimulation is said to be without an original, that is, without an essence. Derrida says, I quote, "It is impossible to dissociate the questions of art, style, and truth from the question of the woman. And the question, what is woman, is itself suspended by the simple formulation of their common problematic." So the question is suspended, but dissimulation is not. In fact, what makes the link between the two Nietzsche is dissimulation. And what is problematic, according to me, is that anti-essentialism as essentialism lay foundation on the same concept, which is imitation. In Gender Trouble, Judith Butler also defines gender performativity as a capacity to imitate without a model. In that sense, Gender Trouble remains Nietzschean. One simulates one's own gender without referring to an original. I quote from Butler. "The notion of gender parody," and in French it is translated, parody is translated by imitation, precisely. "The notion of gender parody, defended here, does not assume that there is an original with which such parodic identities imitate. Indeed," she goes on, "the parody is off the very notion of the original. Gender parody reveals that the original identity after which gender fashions itself is an imitation without an origin. To be more precise, it is a production which, in effect, that is, in its effect, postures an imitation." End of quote. And she has this other affirmation, which is very close to Derrida's conclusions in Spurs. I quote again, genders can be neither true nor false, neither real nor apparent, neither original nor derived. As credible bearers of those attributes, however, genders can also be rendered thoroughly and radically incredible. Okay, so here again we find this anti-essentialism founded on the paradigm of imitation. Imitation without models, but still imitations. Parody, imitation without an origin, postured imitations, all these terms, again, are meant to deconstruct the original copy model, of course, okay, but they still refer to it as their structural schema. If I had time, I would demonstrate that art, since Nietzsche, perhaps, has become the paradigmatic expression of all non-essentialist conceptions of gender identity, whatever their differences and apparent lines of fracture. My claim is that such an artistic understanding of the absence of essence is catastrophic. It is a catastrophe for women. It is a catastrophe for gender identity in general and for artists themselves. Artistic ontology is a catastrophe to art and to ontology. Artistic ontology, imitation without model, is catastrophic to women and to gender identity in general. Why that? Because again, it is highly repressive and normative, and this highly repressive character appears, I will just give an example, in the passage which Derrida devotes to Jews in Spurs, precisely. He talks about women, he talks about style, and then he has this little passage on Jews in Nietzsche. So let me quote this passage. "In its eulogy of play acting, of the delight in dissimulation," and Derrida, of course, quotes Nietzsche, "of histrionics and the dangerous concept of the artists, in joyful wisdom, ranks both Jews and women among those expert mountebanks, the artists. That Jews and women should be thus associated does not seem at all insignificant, and the fact that Nietzsche often considers them in parallel roles, might in fact be related to the motive of castration and simulacrum, for which circumcision is the mark, indeed the name of the mark. Such is the indication of the conclusion to the fragments on the histrionic capacity. Nietzsche asks, what good actor at present is not a Jew? The Jew also, as a born literary man, exercises his power on the basis of his histrionic capacity. For the literary man is essentially an actor. He plays the part of expert, of specialist. Finally, women. If we consider the whole history of women, are they not obliged, first of all and above all, to be actresses? So end of quote, end of Derrida's quote and Nietzsche's quote. So you see, the discourse on artists, women artists, is also a discourse on the Jew. And you can see all the ambiguity of that kind of discourse. Like, women and Jews are experts in dissimulation. So even if there is no model, even if we can say, yes, but this dissimulation is without a model, it remains a dissimulation. And of course, it is a very dangerous and suspicious discourse. Of course, Derrida will show that as there is a double discourse on women in Nietzsche, there's a double discourse on artists and on Jews in Nietzsche, one essentialist and inacceptable, the other non-essentialist and deconstructive. But nevertheless, as I said, the anti-essentialism, as it is defined here, is very dangerous because it still assimilates identity with simulation. In my eyes, to claim that all women are artists is no less unacceptable than to claim that all Jews are actors or that all genders are parodic. So now to conclude, I will ask this question. Why is anti-essentialism artistically missing its goal? Because it is guilty of an ontological mistake. It confuses essence and being. One can say that women or Jews or artists have no being, okay, but it is not possible to say, ontologically speaking, that they have no essence. Such a deprivation is a violent deprivation of power. The distinction between being, in Greek toon, and essence, ousia, wesen, is present in all foundational philosophical systems. Hegel is certainly the philosopher who insists more powerfully upon their difference. Being, he says, has no foundation in itself. It is an immediate presence which can easily disappear in its contrary. For example, now is morning will soon die in favor of another being, now is evening. Being's capacity to transform itself into another being or into its contrary is precisely the essence of being. The essence in this sense is the past of being, its origin as a transformative power. I can't resist the pleasure, I don't know if it will be a pleasure for you, to read the beginning of the second volume of The Science of Logic devoted to the notion of essence in its difference with being. I quote Hegel, the truth of being is essence. Being is the immediate. Since knowing has for its goal knowledge of the true, knowledge of what being is in and for itself, it does not stop at the immediate and its determinations, but penetrates it on the supposition that at the back of this being there is something else than being itself, that this background constitutes the truth of being, okay? So behind being, there's something else, and this something else is the essence, but it is never obvious. It is always hidden. The German language, Hegel goes on, has preserved essence in the past participle, gewesen, or the verb of the verb to be, okay? So German says to be and gewesen, to be what? Sein. And gewesen. For essence is past, Hegel says, but timely past being. So, end of quote, essence is not being, it is the recollection of being into itself, and then appears as its back, its past, what makes it possible as being, its truth. And if it is true, if it is the truth of being, that being always passes into another being, is always negated by and as another being, it then means that the essence of being precisely characterizes its originary transformability, its originary capacity to move, disappear, emerge again, in other terms, its plasticity. Essence is the plasticity of being. The great and definitive philosophical gesture which Hegel accomplishes on and with plasticity is precisely to delocalize it from its immediate origin, which is the artistic realm. Hegel says the great mistake to understand plasticity is to understand it as an artistic term. Of course, originally it designates sculpture, plastic art, but in fact its genuine meaning, its actual domain of significance is ontological, and it is the domain of subjectivity. To be is to be negated. In the first place, this constant debasement appears as a lack of essence. It seems that the law of being is constant negation or death or disappearance. This precisely because essence is not a fixed entity that would preserve being from destruction and negation. On the contrary, essence is what reveals being through negation as transformability and mutability. A truth which Heidegger, in his lectures on Nietzsche, will express as essence is changeable in itself. Again, essence is the plasticity of being. Of course, such a plasticity may very well appear through art. There may be very well artistic expressions of the ontological, but the artistic, understood as what suspends the difference between true and untrue, is by no means the primary meaning of plasticity, because the primary meaning of plasticity is truth. Truth is its own transformability. Woman will be my subject. Woman will not have been my subject. Woman negates this negation itself. The third moment is the moment when the negation of woman's being reveals the essence of woman as her own capacity to change and negate the negation of her being itself. The plastic essence appears as a metamorphic power which exceeds simulation, as a conatus, as an energy, a force of resistance which coincides with an identity. To go back to Sartre in conclusion, because I think this is what he says, that there is a negative essence, a dialectical essence, we can refer to his affirmation, and we go back to the problem of the Jew again. To be a Jew is to be thrown into, to be abandoned to the situation of a Jew. And at the same time, it is to be responsible in and through one's own person for the destiny and the very nature of the Jewish people. For whatever the Jew says or does, and whether he has a clear or vague conception of his responsibilities, it is as if all acts were subject to a Kantian imperative, as if he had to ask himself before each act, if all Jews acted as I'm going to do, what would happen to Jewish life? And to the question he asks himself, what would happen if all the Jews were Zionists, or if, on the contrary, they were all converted to Christianity? If all Jews denied they were Jews, etc., he must remake a reply alone and unaided by choosing himself. So I think we could replace here every time the concept, well, the word Jew by that of woman, and it would work perfectly. He breaks, the Jew breaks all his ties with the Jewish community, and yet he finds that community again in the depth of his art, for he experiences in his very flesh the humiliations that the anti-Semites impose upon other Jews, end of quote. Sartre's definition of plasticity and thus of essence would then be an essence which is defined out of negation and which appears positively as being in a situation. Again, we can replace the term Jew by that of woman. I will be asked to specify the specificity of the woman if it is true that what can be said about her also apply to Jews or to anyone fighting for recognition or equality of rights. I think that all cases of violence are specific, and that if there is a general and dialectical structure of essence and essentiality, there are particular types of violence. The violence made to women, as we know, is domestic abuse, sexual abuse, forced prostitution, exploitation, machism, etc. We are all in a situation, but there is a plasticity of situations. From the situation I am in as a woman and not out of imitation, I can say in the end that woman will have been my topic. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you for a very interesting lecture. And maybe we can now start the conversation part. I hope that you won't mind me asking some questions that are not directly related to the problems which you raised in your lecture, but something that you mentioned and that you wrote about extensively in your book, Changing Difference. I'm very interested if you could explain a little bit more that position of yours, which is particular in the fact that you somehow disapprove in a way of radical gender deconstructionism, yes, and at the same time you have the same of course the question of essentialism is very clear, and if you can just elaborate a little bit more on your statement that the violence that is done to women in the name of essentialism is not the same violence being done from the other part, but that gender constructivism and gender performativity includes a certain amount of violence, and that it's also so. Okay. Please, thank you.
Well, thank you for this question. So the argument is rather simple. It is that for, let's say now, perhaps 40 years or so, feminism has moved from what was called an essentialist perspective, which tended to define the woman as a subject, precisely, a certain kind of subject, to an erasure of all ontological specificity of the woman. So, for example, when Beauvoir says, we're not born women, we become one, it was still considered an essentialist kind of proposition, because it relied on the verb to be and to become, so it was still ontologically founded. And then came, well, I make a long story short, of course, came the, let's say, gender theory, which on the contrary affirmed, and it started with Judith Butler mainly, that if there is an ontology of gender, it can only be a parodic ontology. That in fact, the verb is, cannot, when she says that genders are just imitations, it means that we don't have the verb, the ontological verb to characterize what a gender is, precisely because it is not. The proposition, I am a woman, or I am a man, or I am, I don't know, is not possible. Okay, so this is anti-essentialism, which also means that there's no natural sexual difference. So if you deconstruct the ontology, you also deconstruct naturality, normativity of heterosexuality, etc. This is, of course, a very convincing discourse, and at the same time, something is, for me, problematic to the extent that this expresses a conception of ontology which has to be discussed. I think anti-essentialism relies on a too traditional concept of ontology, which precisely has been criticized and deconstructed already by Hegel, like being is always negative, that it is never substantial. When I say I am a woman, it doesn't mean that this am is something fixed and solid, but that this is a movement. So first by Hegel and then later on by Heidegger, according to which being is transformable, mutable, plastic. And for me, there is a problem because in anti-essentialism, this plasticity of being is not expressed, is not taken into account. And I'm not, as a woman, I'm not satisfied either by the idea that my femininity would only be an imitation without any consistency. So that's what I'm trying to develop without, I hope, going back to essentialism, because this is not my point either.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for your answer. Well, as you said, and as you pointed out in your lecture, the concept of essence has been largely misunderstood, and largely misunderstood usually in the way when it comes to mean a substance, which is not. So the way you interpret the concept of essence is by always referring to the concept of plasticity. And at the same time, while applying your central concept of plasticity to the question, to all gender questions, then you point out different figures in which we can, different figures which represent our ways of seeing a subject. What I have in mind here is your excellent tripartite division of the ability of the organism to recover itself. When you said in your book Changing Difference, when you interpret Hegel's sentence, the wounds of spirit leave no scars, and then you give three interpretations, which one you name the paradigm of the phoenix, the second is the paradigm of the spider, yeah, that would be deconstructive, and the third is the paradigm of the salamander. And if you can just elaborate here more on, or tell our audience, and I'm sure they would love to hear it, that this paradigm of the salamander, I think that it can be extremely helpful and useful in the way we can rethink and think the feminine without falling either in the trap of essentialism or anti-essentialism.
Yes, okay, thank you. So I won't expose the whole thing because it would be too long, and I'm sure that we can start the discussion. It was just, you know, that if you cut the leg of a salamander, it regrows. And I'm very much interested in the paradigm of regeneration and regrowth. And it's about the same type of thing which I just presented in my discourse. Like, you negate, but out of this negation, something is regrowing. And this is what I see through this paradigm of the salamander. You negate the leg, I mean, there's a cutting out, and at the same time, something is regenerating, which is not the same as the amputated limb, but which is something new, and at the same time, the same thing. This is what, well, in other terms, I very much believe in the necessity to re-elaborate a dialectical Hegelian paradigm. So, but I think, yes, we might perhaps open.
Maybe at this point we can open up discussion and take some questions from the audience. Yes, we have a question there, please.
Thank you very much for your interesting talk. I would like to know, maybe you can comment on this one. Is there any historical specificity of the moment of being thrown into the identity of woman slash Jew? I wonder, because I remember this argument of Slavoj Žižek in his A Sublime Object of Ideology, where he said that he elaborated that the Jew is a specific symptom of Nazi Germany not being able to be a truly collective and not socially and economically divided society. So for him, Jew is a symptom of a specific historical moment. And in a way, this kind of essentialism and anti-essentialism is related to specific socio-economic moment in which women are not thrown into their identities the same in every historical moment, but rather in every historical moment, Jews, women, slash every other subjectivity is thrown into its identity in a specific way. I wonder if you can comment on this one, and is there any specific way in which a woman is thrown into neoliberal capitalist society today? Because it seems to me that this kind of anti-essentialism fits well with this post-ideological world.
What do you mean by post-ideological?
My question was related to, is there any specific moment? That would be another specific question, but okay, I can elaborate. Maybe it's too long to elaborate all that, but
okay,
I'm
referring
to Slavoj Žižek's concept of post-ideology.
Okay.
He is referring to Sloterdijk's concept of cynical ideology. There are lots of concepts of post-ideological world, so-called, but maybe we can stick only to that part.
No, I understand. Thank you for your question. Of course, it's interesting, but I would say that you know, it's both. That is, there's a kind of atemporal, eternal, everlasting essentialism, like the identity of the Jew, for example, which has been defined by the anti-Semite quite a traditional way, and this discourse remains what it is all along history. And of course, at the same time, there are some determinate moments in which this essence crystallizes into a very violent rejection. So in Sartre's discourse, it is very clear that anti-Semitism is both something which is everlasting, which is almost a myth, something with no origin and no history proper, and at the same time, something historical. And for women, it's the same thing. Of course, there are moments when women are more rejected. But what surprises me is that in our very advanced capitalistic moment, violences done to women are so traditional. So it's so surprising how things hadn't changed at all. So I would say, to answer your question, that is both. History and non-history are really intermingling at this point.
We have a question there.
Thank you, Professor Malabou, for this inspirative lecture. I have two questions for you. First is, how does your concept of plasticity relate to the current movements in philosophy, including so-called speculative realists, speculative realism? And second question is, do you think your philosophy is closer to Heidegger or Derrida? Thank you.
Well, thank you. Okay, so these are huge questions. And speculative realism.
So I don't know if you all know what it is. Speculative realism, it's a fabric narrative, which is not really fair, because the origin of this movement is a young French philosopher. His name is Quentin Meissou, and he wrote that book, After Finitude. And then someone said, oh, we might call the trend speculative realism. So it's not a very faithful name. But to say briefly in two words, what Meissou is doing in that book is that we should now go beyond Kant and stop considering that the world is ours. That is, that the world is only what we know of the world. In other terms, that the transcendental is the origin of all relationship to the world. Meissou says the world exists independently of me. So we have to access a reality, hence speculative realism, which is beyond our approach, which is absolutely indifferent to our existence. A world which is absolutely real without me, whether I exist or not. And in that sense, what Kant says, the a priori subjectivity, et cetera, falls down. The world is absolutely indifferent to us. So, the problem for us philosophers today is, can we really, I switched topics a little bit here. The problem is, are we done with the transcendental? This is a very, very acute question for us today. It looks very technical, but it is not. It means, can we approach the world? Can we understand the world? Can we understand reality if we don't use something like a set of structures, which are concepts, categories, judgments, everything which Kant called the transcendental, and which are a set of tools which help us to grasp reality? What if all that assemblage disappears and we're facing like a raw world, a kind of absolute reality with no grasp? So what can we do? Okay, so this is very, very, in a very sketchy way, what Meissou says. My approach is like exactly the same type of answer about essentialism. I think we need a third term. We don't have the transcendental, the total negation of the transcendental, like Meissou does. We need a third term. Of course, we can't do without a substitute of the transcendental. Okay, so this is what I'm trying to argue. Okay, and so, to answer your question, it's linked with plasticity because it means that the transcendental is plastic, and perhaps it has an existence after Kant in another way. So we have to think of a plasticity of the transcendental. And the second question, I'm sorry, I forgot. It's about Heidegger. You know, it's a problem because, of course, today to refer to Heidegger is not politically correct. But I must say, there is something in Heidegger about precisely the plasticity of essence also, something like the transformative power of things, which I think is more profound than what Derrida says about difference. Derrida is all about displacement, you know, the trace which goes like that, trace and style and things. But Heidegger would agree with that. Behind that, there is like this paste, transformable paste of things, metamorphosis, etc., which I think we need in order to think of transformation, changing, etc. So.
Sorry, you wanted to ask?
What I about what? About. If I'm closer. I'm closer to Derrida because he's more sympathetic politically. But there's something in Heidegger which is very difficult to give up, I think. No, thank you for your question.
So do we have some more questions? I'm sure that you have something to ask our guest. I have a lot of questions, but it wouldn't be politically correct. I should leave some space to the audience. Well, as I'm highly unwilling to do that, I will have to ask you a few more questions, if that's okay, or
yeah,
maybe just we still have plenty of time. This one will be very short. I really liked the last chapter of your book, Changing Difference. And as we spoke earlier, you said that you thought, or that people said that it was too, not personal, but too autobiographical. But I think that in order to escape that definition of the feminine, which never gets embodied anywhere, then you said you will speak as a woman philosopher, and you the title of that chapter is Women's Possibility, Philosophy's Impossibility. So if you can just tell our audience something about your formation as a philosopher and those three stages, which I think you defined very well in relation to your obviously femaleness, or the first one was acting if, the second acting together, and the third acting without. So I really liked that chapter very much. So I'm sorry, but you'll have to tell us something about it. Yes.
Okay, thank you. You know, in philosophy, most of the time, and it's of course always true. Of course, women do philosophy now, just like men, and you have female philosophy students and female professors, etc. The question is that we don't have a woman philosopher proper. We wouldn't be able to give a name. Well, perhaps very few, perhaps Simone de Beauvoir or Simone Weil, but it is not that easy to give a name. And also, most of the time, women do philosophy, but they never approach precisely the problem of ontology. It's very seldom to find a woman specialized, let's say, in metaphysics, like arguing about being, essence, etc., etc. So the very core of philosophy, the highly treasured, you know, the sacred place of philosophy is metaphysics, and particularly in metaphysics, ontology. So in that book, I try to understand why that, you know, why women more often did aesthetics, for example, hence my problem with the artistic paradigm, aesthetics or applied philosophy or feminism or gender theory, why do they specialize in domains which are more like applied philosophy than like the hard stuff, which is what is being, et cetera, et cetera. And I think this is because they are educated in that way. It is because it is very, because it is the heart of philosophy. Men are extremely defensive on that point. And when I was a student, sometimes the teacher said, this is not necessary for you girls to listen to that, because this is too difficult for you, you know? It is an ontological problem. You're not trained in that. You can't. So for me, the challenge was to always remain in this, to never do applied philosophy, never. To always remain here, in this little... So the problem is when we do that, okay, if we conquer that space, and show that we are capable of discussing with whoever about Aristotle, Hegel, you know, when we're not afraid anymore to get on the ring and start fighting. The problem is what happens? Are we still women or are we become men? And this is the problem I have. What is it to remain a woman when doing something which normally is reserved to men? And I think there must be a feminine way of doing that, but it is very difficult to say what it is. I think it is a kind of subversion, precisely. I think it's a kind of style, but what is it? And so this is my question. No.
Okay, thank you very much for your answer. We have a question there.
Just to add to this, would the subversion eventually be that the core of philosophy did not be the essence and the core of what the men philosophers did,
what you call the margin? Could margin move to the center? Could exactly gender theory and could exactly known the core of philosophy, the one that women were dealing, be it? Could this be the subversion? Why to compete that the core is, let's say, the old philosophy? Yeah.
Okay, you're right, but it has been like that for years, like margins. I'm myself very marginal. I've always worked with marginal people like Derrida or people like that. Okay, I'm not the institution type at all. And at the same time, something is not totally satisfactory with the idea of the margin. The margin is necessary, but we also need to be in the center. I wouldn't have been totally pleased with the idea of staying in the margins of all my life. I needed to go to the treasure, to the shrine. I needed to do that. I needed to do that. To yes. Because otherwise, you can say, of course, I'm a woman, I'm a philosopher, and I'm doing marginal things. Okay, but you know, something is missing as well.
To shift the paradigm, that the margin become the center.
At the same time, is there something more interesting in philosophy than the question of essence? You know, if we remove that, if we are not interested in that, it's weak, I don't know. This is the way I see things. I understand what you say, and at the same time, well, we need the essential as well. It's also because it's also my own pleasure. I think it's fun to introduce femininity in that. It's fun. You know, Irigaray did it is fun.
Okay, so do we have more questions?
I just have one question. Do you think that we can subverse in our society the over-sexualization of the women's body, and capitalism? Do you think that this is possible?
Why wouldn't it be possible? Well. Yeah, I know. It's unbearable. I know, I agree. But this is our task. This is what we have to do. Is it possible? I don't think so. I mean, given the state of things, I think that, unfortunately, this is a very powerful trend. But yes, I think our duty is to subvert that. Now is precisely the imitation artistic paradigm. Is that enough? This is what I wonder. Because it's true that in gender theory, the notion of parody, the notion of performativity, etc., we're playing with these representations of the body. We're trying to subvert them by imitation, by transvestite, etc. Is that enough? Don't we need something more ontological, more solid? This is also my question.
Okay, here I am with the same questions. Any more questions? Actually, I was going to ask you about something I missed out on, about when you said that practically there, in philosophy, there are no women, there are no female predecessors as there are in literature, in art, in painting, for example. And then in your book you mention Lucy Rigaret as one example, and that would be consider her work and under the title acting together, acting with. So, what do you think that the way Rigaret actually does her very specific subversion of philosophy is powerful and operative, and is there any other way than to master this masterful discourse and then to act from within it and
so
subvert it?
I remember that, thank you for this question. I remember that both Beauvoir and Irigaray said, and I think they're right, that the specificity of the feminine philosophical discourse, if it has one, is that the women will always identify a neglected part of the body in order to found their discourse. Well, they will also always associate a concept with a body part. For example, Irigaray, she has worked on the lips. And for her, her concept of the feminine, but also her concept of the truth, of essence, etc., is linked with the lips. And in Beauvoir, it's about the whole body of the woman aging in the second sex, for example. So I remember that they say that what a woman will do, if there is something like a specificity, is always to identify the rejection of women with a rejection of a body part, of something which is never mentioned or never really taken into account. And I think that what I'm trying to do in my, it struck me that I'm interested in the brain and in neurology, and I think that the brain is for me the kind of bodily part which has never been taken into account in philosophy. And I think that perhaps what the woman does is to enter the realm of philosophy by introducing a reflection on a certain body part which has not been analyzed or taken into account. That's why Erigra is so important for me, because this is what she clearly did. Like, as women, we are lips. And this is by using this kind of entry that she revisits all ontology and everything. And I think this is very strong. Mm.
Thank you for this lovely answer. Any more questions?
But if there are not, we can stop.
Well, maybe we can just elaborate a bit more on Irigaray and what you just said. I think that what you just said might be a perfect solution. And as you said, there is this, there are those forgotten body parts, and for you, that specific body part or an organ that you want to introduce into philosophy, which has never been considered in philosophy, is the brain, and therefore you are, I think you are performing your own subversion through.
Yes, it's very interesting in the body to see how, in philosophy at least, in the body how certain parts have been valorized, like valued, sorry, like the heart, like the soul, the phallus. And some others, and the liver also, Prometheus, etc. Some others, like the lips. And in my case, the brain. You know, if you look at the whole history of philosophy, the brain is never mentioned, or practically never. It's just, well, an organ of transmission, but it has no autonomy. It's not the spirit, it is not the mind, it is, you know, something obscure. And it is interesting to associate this with the status of the woman. Like, we are part of a body, like the social body, but always in a secondary, dark, obscure place. And perhaps the way that in which we women act, enter the space of theory or philosophy is perhaps this, to find a door which is always physical. So I think the first who said that was de Beauvoir. She said to plug a concept on a body.
Thank you for this answer. Yes, precisely. I agree with you that this that any form of subversion, should necessarily take the path that you've mentioned, that at this point that there is no other path. So, but if I can just ask something about as you said, that the history of philosophy knows no brain. And basically, what I particularly like about your work, that you managed to establish a dialogue between life sciences and philosophy and humanities. And I generally think that there should be a stronger dialogue between humanities and social sciences on one side, and life sciences in general on the other side. But there, I haven't encountered too many examples. Actually, I've encountered only a few examples of anybody
of course.
Having established such a dialogue. So, if you could just tell us why is it so problematic to establish such a dialogue? Is it the rigidity of social constructivists or biological reductionism on the other hand?
Well, it's a complicated question. First of all, it's because neurology today is very powerful and it is overpowering all the human sciences to the extent that gradually our human sciences are transforming themselves into neurosciences like neurolinguistics, even neuroeconomy, everything, neuropsychoanalysis. So of course there's a defensive reaction from all the people in our departments, let's say, which will react in the negative sense, the Nietzschean sense, and turn their backs on that, saying, we're not interested, this is not important. So it's defense. And on the other side, from the side of the neurosciences, you have this reductionist discourse. So both an attacking, you attack and defense. This is very simple, in fact. But what we need is an intermediary position where we would bring the fluidity which is missing from both parts. But of course, this is always the most difficult thing to do. Because to transform the terms of a struggle, like attack and defense, is certainly the most difficult thing in theory. Think, for example, of the difficulties which Freud encountered when he started to talk about psychoanalysis was exactly the same thing. Two sides and a violent fight. And to fluidify the resistances on both sides is certainly what is the most difficult. So perhaps it will come, but at the moment it is like two war fronts. And I was talking to Dunia last night. The problem is that if we go on defending ourselves in the humanities and not trying to open ourselves to these new fields, we'll lose the battle. Clearly, we will be the losers because they are more powerful, as there was. They have, you were talking about capitalism. Capitalism is entirely behind neurosciences. It is their weapon. If we go on ignoring them and being in a solely defensive position, we'll lose the game for sure.
Yes, so. Thank you for this answer. It's absolutely, as you said, we are losing this game if we don't engage into a dialogue with life sciences. And as you mentioned, Freud, I think that maybe Freud might have been the first to put together two discourses. One was biological, energetic discourse, and the other was very, very humanistic, and that was this hermeneutic part. And I think that what Freud did at his time, was very, very subversive. And in this tone, I think the most subversive thing that we can do today is precisely to link life sciences and your humanities.
Yes, but it implies so many displacements in Freud. It implies such a transformation of psychoanalysis that what used to appear as a very subversive discourse, which was psychoanalysis, now appears as a conservative discourse most of the time. So, that's the problem, you know.
Maybe some questions about psychoanalysis.
Not about this. I don't know if you know the films of Jean-Luc Godard. And yeah, I just in my dissertation I wrote about the deconstruction of sexualized femininity in the films of Jean-Luc Godard. And and I claimed that Godard is a feminist filmmaker, even if most of the time he was criticized by feminists for being for representing the women in a bad way, and in his films in a lot of films of Jean-Luc Godard the women are bad treated. And I just thought that I just claimed that this kind of provocation of the of the man's concept of femininity has this effect that it deconstructs over-sexualized femininity in that way, that it's a similar effect which has pornography and other representations of the women's bodies. I just wanted to ask you if you have any statement towards the films of Jean-Luc Godard.
It's very interesting, but no, I'm afraid that I can't. No answer. I'm not specialized in that, so my knowledge of Godard is very, it's not sufficient. It's not sufficient. Sorry.
We have a question
there. I wanted to ask you, how do you manage to reconcile the concept of psychoanalytical unconscious and cerebral unconscious, which is more present in cognitive sciences, and we all know that there are science wars between these two military camps, so to say.
So when I was young, we followed a certain way. Like Freud started to be, as you know, he started as a neurologist and then became the father of psychoanalysis. Now I'm trying to do the inverted way, the reverse, going in reverse. The opposite way, like starting from psychoanalysis and going back to neurology, and trying to understand why exactly Freud turned his back to neurology, and what in fact is still present in his notion of the unconscious from neurology. So I'm trying to revive, in a way, the neurological memory of Freud, because I'm certain that even in his rejection of neurobiology, something remains in the elaboration of the unconscious. Which is, I guess, we don't have time to get into details, but which is, I guess, the concept of trauma.
Do you think that with the development of so-called neurosciences and affective sciences, so-called traumas will be located and treated with, I don't know, some kind of electrostimulators and microchips and etc., that we will no longer need a talking cure and these humanistic approaches?
No, but it's not like that.
Yeah. I'm not saying it is. I'm just asking because there are many people who are all pro-natural sciences and that think that future is in, I don't know, this transhumanism, implants, and that, I mean, as you said, and Elizabeth Rudinesco argues in her book, Pourquoi la psychanalyse, she's defending this humanistic psychoanalysis today is a conservative.
If you read Lacanians, they will defend psychoanalysis and say,
So how to reconcile these two fields? I mean, it's really hard because...
It's a huge question.
Yeah, I know.
The vision according to which neurobiology would just robotize us.
Yeah.
Is certainly not. I mean, if we start like that, we are in the defensive position I was just mentioning, you mm-hmm. know? If you say, oh, they want to replace the talking cure by a series of chips and implementations, this is precisely what we shouldn't do.
Yeah.
Okay? And regarding chips, yeah. If they find a way to cure people from Alzheimer's patients, if they can cure them by implementing chips, that's a good thing, mm-hmm. okay? But fundamentally, the problem is not there. Mm-hmm. The problem is what part does the brain play in the psyche? Mm-hmm. This is the true problem. Chips and things is secondary. You know, if we invert that and say, oh, no, this is the important thing, they want to transform us into machines, we are all wrong. Because we don't hear what's going on. Okay. See what I mean?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I think we can perhaps stop.
Yes, I think we can stop at this point. Thank you very much
for the questions.
Yes.